social. So I'm happy to say that I have a lot of friends.
Okay, I'm back. Okay, I've got all my slots slotted out with my hobby knife. I've got all my CA hinges cut, and I got them marked in the center. Now, is what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to take my hinges, and I'm going to take T-pins, and I'm going to stick them right on that mark. Fairly centered. Okay. And let me see, I believe there's four of them per aileron. I'm going to go ahead and stick those through quite a ways. And I'm going to be needing eight of them to do both ailerons. Oh, hey, that one's hard to push it through. There it goes. All right, there's eight of them. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to take my ailerons and I'm going to push these up. And hard to tell at first. I usually just go in the center of my slot. As soon as you try to fit them up, you'll be able to tell exactly where they go, but I just go kind of in the center of my slot. I slotted earlier, and that's a good starting point. And I go ahead and I push them down and try to keep them pretty square and push them right down to my T-pin. And if you get one that won't go all the way down, you can just take your razor knife and your hobby knife, and you can just go ahead and slot it out a little more. I got one there that's not going all the way down. So just go ahead and open it up a little bit more with my hobby knife. Actually, it seems like a dull hobby knife works a little better for these. A real sharp one tends to track off to the side. A dull one seems to work a little better. It's kind of odd. See, that one's still not going all the way up. I really want to get it all the way to my halfway mark on that. I want it to go halfway in one side, and I want it to go halfway in the other, so I just keep on cutting it out until that goes down. Should work pretty soon here. Okay, I believe there it goes. Okay, so let me go ahead and get these fitted in, and I get a little further along, I'll be back. Okay, I got all my hinges put on here and slid up to my T-pins. Now I'm going to very carefully try to fit it up to my wing and see how they fit. Trying to line up, I usually just start with one end here. Try to get one started. Actually, these holes were so tight that I'm gonna go over them again with a dull hobby knife. A dull hobby knife seems to open them up a little bit more than a sharp one. Sometimes a sharp one doesn't work that well. dull one opens them up and gets a little bit of room. I'm gonna go over these one more time because they're really tight. So I'm gonna go ahead and go over these with the dull hobby knife, and as soon as I get them all done, I'll be back to test fit my ailerons onto my wing. Okay, I'm test fitting my aileron to my wing, and I'm, it's kind of hard to get these started, and this one's the tightest one I've probably ever had, but once you kind of get them started in the groove, you can just pull them back and forth, and as what that'll do, it'll kind of wiggle those hinges and put a little pressure in it, on it, and you just wiggle it back and forth and see how they're starting to slide up. Okay, and of course I'm wanting to get them all the way up to my pins. I'm wanting to get that as tight as I can. Really don't want to leave any gap here at all. Just very, very little. So I slid them up and I'm getting really close to all the way up on those, but I've still got a little bit of a gap. So in the end I want this edge to line up with my wing, so I'm going to go ahead and push that up a little. And of course I'm still wiggling it back and forth trying to get that as close as I can. There it's starting to go. Okay, I want the edge of my wing to line up and I want those to push all the way in. Okay, that one, I'm getting there. It really take a lot of effort to get these pushed all the way up, because if you don't, they will flutter in the air. Almost put too much pressure on it. I'm gonna damage something if I don't watch it. These parts are pretty delicate, and when you're putting that kind of pressure on them, trying to push them up and stuff, it would be an easy time to damage them. And I don't believe I did, but did kind of slip on me. Make sure I didn't hurt anything. Doesn't appear like I did. If I had broken the structure a little bit, you can make a small slice and wick a little bit of CA into your joint there and repair them, but okay, I believe I've got that one on there. Okay, now I'm going to go to my other side. Do the same thing. So, I'm going to go ahead and work on test fitting my other side, my other aileron on my wing. And once I get it slid up, I'll be back. Okay, I got everything fitted up. I got my T-pins, I got them pushed all the way up. Now granted, when I glue these, I'm gonna push them up again. And of course, I'm getting ready to wick a CA into each one of these. Okay, and is what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna tilt it down here. Try to get to where you can see what I'm doing. And I'm going to use about 6 drops on each one. I do 3 on either side. And so I go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then I move it back and forth a little bit. I try not to get it up on the sides, but sometimes you do, and that's fine. I can use a debonder. Okay, I got 6 on each one of those. Now, I've got just a little bit up on this edge here. I'm going to go ahead and wipe that off with a paper towel. I can go back with the bonder later and clean it up real nice, but I just got a little bit up on the edge. It wipes right off. Okay. Now, of course, I'm making sure it's pushed up still, that I haven't changed anything in the process of messing with it, because these can move around. And I'm going to twist my T-pins, and I'm going to go ahead and pull them out. Okay, looking at it and making sure that it's still where it needs to be. And of course I use 6 drops on each one. Making sure my edge is still where it needs to be. Appears to be real good. And I didn't leave any more gap than I absolutely had to there. Now granted, they're along the control surface, so there'll be spaces that are a little closer than others. I don't know if that's slight warping or what causes that, but as long as you get them pushed up all the way that you can, all the way to your T-pins, it'll be fine. You just don't want any more than you possibly have to have there. And I've got my other side here pushed up. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to wick 6 drops in each spot on this. These little tips that I use, they really help on stuff like this to be able to pinpoint a little bit.
Little Bo Peep has lost her sheep because someone broke into her apartment and stole all her sheep, not to mention a 50-inch flat-screen TV.
Sometimes 6 drops seems to be a little much, but she really needs to wick back into that wood.
She has since trained her sheep to do voice impressions of various attack dogs, and now feels very safe.
So, it's not. Okay. Got 6 drops into each one of those. My CA hinges, I want to make sure that hasn't moved on me. And it looks real good, so I'm going to go ahead and start pulling my T-pins, and I just twist them and pull them out. If you leave those in, they'll be awful hard to get out later because the CA will dry on them. It can be removed later, but really need to go ahead and remove them. That way they won't be stuck in there. Okay, there's my CA hinges. Now, CA does take a little while to go ahead and cure out, so I'm just going to set that aside for a minute and go ahead and put up my T-pins and seal up my glue and figure out what to do next. So I'll be right back. Okay, I got my servos built. I got my little grommets and everything in them. Now I'm just going to set them here in my wings. One at a time. Make sure they're going to go down in there. Some of these are a little tight. If they're too tight, you have to go ahead and open that opening up a little bit, which I hate to do because I like to iron my covering around my edges. Which really, it looks like they're going to go. They're going to be a little tight. Be real careful on stuff like this. You can break stuff. So if you just wiggle it back and forth, see that end is catching a little bit. If you just wiggle it back and forth and take your time, a lot of that wood will go ahead and compress a little bit and give you some more room to where it'll fit in there. Even if they're a little tight, you can usually go ahead to get them to pop down in the holes. If you're careful, don't force them. If you just try to pop it down in there, your wood's going to break. But if you put your edges of your servo, is what I do, is I put my edge in there and I turn it back and forth. Be careful not to break your servo housing. But is what that does, that just gives that wood a little bit of a indention to give that servo just a little more room. Anyway, I'm going to go ahead and work with that for a little bit and try to get my servo to pop down in that hole. And also check my other one. And as soon as I get them down in there, I'll be back. Okay, I actually had to file down the front edge where my servo holes are with this little file. And I just did one edge because, as you've seen earlier, I take and I do my my covering. I set it up to where my covering will go down in my servo holes to help hold on to my covering. But it's what I had to do since my servos, and some servos are a little bit different sizes. So it's what I had to do is I had to file down that little edge on the back side to make my servo set in there. So I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to start drilling my hole. Holes for my servos. Use a little Ryobi drill. 1/16 inch bit. And I'm just going to try to center them. And I'm going to drill one hole. Is what I'm going to do for starters. Be careful not to poke it all the way through the other side. And then I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to get a bit that fits my servo screws that come with my servos. I'm going to get a bit that fits them really well. And I've actually sanded this bit down to make it work really well on my hardware. Because this hardware is just pretty low quality, and if you're really careful with it and you make sure your bits fit it and everything, you can get by with it, but otherwise you won't. I'm just going to thread one of those in a little ways. And then I'm going to go ahead. Actually, I'm going to loosen that one up. I tightened it up a little too tight. I just kind of want to hold it in place here. Alrighty. Now, with one screw in it, I'm going to go ahead and drill another one of my holes. Back that out a little bit. I've actually pulled it down tight enough that it's leaning my servo over. So I really don't want to do that. There we go. Go ahead and drill another 1/16 inch hole on the other side of your servo. And sometimes I lean these to the outside edge of my servo a little bit to give it a little more wood, because these are sitting right on the edge of that wood and it's real easy to split it out. And something else I do, with a little drill bit like this and drilling into that plywood, if you put any pressure on it at all, it's just going to push right through that. And you're not really going to get a hole drilled, you're going to push a hole through. And that will give you very little hold. So you just don't put any pressure on it at all, let the drill bit do the work. So you go ahead and drill a nice hole there. Okay, and I'm going to go ahead and put that one in. Not pulling it down very tight. Now I can drill my other two holes with my 1/16 inch drill bit. Again, leaning it out a little bit. Actually lean the drill in toward the servo here, and that leans the threads to the screws out toward the wood, out toward that way, to get a little bit better bite in the wood. I have had them to where they were awful thin. And they put the wood in and out and stuff. Again, no pressure at all. Let the drill bit do its work. Instead of pushing a hole through it, I want to go ahead and let it drill a hole. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and thread my other two screws in. And then I'll back them out and drop a drop of CA in the hole. I don't need to run them all the way in, I just run them a little ways in. Alright, now I just go ahead and back them right back out. Servo back out. Now I'm going to go ahead and very carefully wick a drop or two down each hole of thin CA. After
78 days of the newborn ICU, we were finally able to bring Bo home on oxygen and a monitor. A baby son that we could feed, hold, and touch. That is why today, 4 years later, all is well, and I am elated. Bo asked me to sing Wagon Wheel.
They really don't need any more than that. If you get any more than that, it'll drip through to your covering underneath and put a spot in your wing, which I've done before. All right. Give that a while to dry, and that servo will be ready to put in and pull my wire through. Now, I'm going to go ahead and do the exact same thing on the other servo, and there's no reason to film that, so I'm going to get that done, and I'll be back. Okay, I'm ready to start mounting my servos up, and I don't know, I might consider getting a better angle. Let me raise the camera up and see if I can get a better angle. Okay, I got a little bit better camera angle. I'm starting to mount my servos. There's a little string down in here that they provide for you, and you can reach down and get it with a pair of hemostats or little needle nose pliers and pull it from the outer side of the wing there. Okay, and it says that your servo leads need to be at least 12 inches, and mine are exactly 12 inches on these servos, so they should be fine. So I'm going to go ahead and tie this onto this end very securely, because I have pulled these loose and it's not that big a deal. I mean, you just run another string through there, or you can weight the end of your servo lead and get it through there, but it's real handy to have these, so if you tie them good, you can. Now I should be able to go into my top piece. This string should be accessible from here. Okay, I see. I actually think it's one string that goes all the way across. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to try to grab it and pull it to this side. Okay, I got a hold of it. It is. It's one string that goes all the way across. So I want to be careful and not pull it loose from my other end. Because then I won't be able to attach it to my servo on that end. Okay, so I got my string, and I'm pulling it through. I'm going to go ahead and lay my wing back over here in a second. Okay. And don't forget, it's real easy to dent these wings up, the covering and the balsa, so be gentle with them on your table. I don't really use a towel. A lot of my friends do. A towel works great. Okay, it looks like from the manual that they're showing your servo set in there like that. So let me see. I should be able to get this. Yeah, here it is. Okay, that lead's pulled out. Now I'm going to go ahead and pop my servo into place. And it looks like from the manual that they're pointing the control horn down, and then they're connecting them outward. And I'm looking for the place that they'll have little piece of plywood, and it's right there. There's plenty of room for it, so that'll work just fine. Now, I already drilled my holes. I've already threaded my screws into my holes, and then I've taken them out and CA'd them. So these are just, they're ready to go. So very carefully, making sure my bit fits my hardware. Don't run them down too tight. Make sure they go in the holes that you provided for them. And these little drills, these little Ryobi drills, I noticed that Home Depot still has these, and probably Lowe's does too. But several months ago, they didn't have them in stock, and I was told that they were discontinued, but they're not. The $39, they come with one battery and a charger, and these are just simply a great tool for building, well, for small hobbies, I guess is what I should say. just really, really the perfect size. And I'll just run these down to where they start to push out the little rubber pieces. That's how I can tell that they're starting to tighten down good. And try not to strip one out or anything. You can always go back, put a little more CA in your hole, and redo them if you need to. But it's easier just to do it right the first time. Okay, there's one. Now let me go to my other side here and do it. And I'm not going to bore you with the exact same thing over again, so I will go ahead and get this one mounted in, and I will be back. Okay, this is the first time I've ever done this way, but it says it in the manual, and it does make sense that it will work real well. I've got my servos mounted down in my wings. They say to use a little silicone piece, which is just a little piece of fuel line, and stretch over these, and that'll tie them together and keep them from pulling through the wing, kind of. So I left my strings attached because these just barely poke through the top of the wing. And what I'm going to do is with a pair of hemostats, I'm going to go ahead and stretch out that fuel line, and I'm going to start it over these two ends. It's kind of a stretch, but it can be done with hemostats. I don't know if you can see this good or not, but there it's going. Now, I just pushed my fuel line down, and I started it over both of them at the same time. And this should really help hold these into place and hold them together. Now, I've never seen this before in any of my books, but it's really a good idea. That fuel line will work perfect to hold those together, hold them in place there. Okay. Now, as you can see, they'll still want to pull through the wing, so I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to leave my string attached to them for right now. But that's a pretty good way to do that, to tie those two together. Now, if I go, I'll probably go separate channels, so I'll go ahead and plug these my extensions on here. I've got 2 6-inch extensions that I'm thinking of using. Okay, and so I'll go ahead and plug those in, and the reason I'm doing this is as opposed to using a Y harness is because I'm going to put my ailerons on separate channels. I like to put them on separate channels. Okay, and that'll help hold them also. Alright, so I've got the servos in the wings. I got them tightened down, and now I've just set my horns on my servos. And I went through this before. I don't cut them off until I hook my receiver up. And I get an idea. One way will set better than the other way. It's always true. So if you just go through and cut your arms off, there's a pretty good chance you made a mistake that you'll have to sub-trim them a lot more to get your 90 degrees. There's one way it'll go on much better. And so I always wait to cut them off. I'm just sticking them on there. Now, I'm going to start on my control horns on my control surfaces, and like I said earlier, I kind of felt in these and made sure that I was halfway lined up with my little plywood blocks, and now I'm going to go ahead and try to find my control surface horns and my hardware for this, and I will be back. Okay, I found my hardware bag, and I found my nylon parts bag, and of course my little Tupperware dish that I use. And I'm going to go ahead and open my bags up, and I'm going to dump them into my dish. Now, some kits have so many nylon parts that I don't mix them. I actually will do this on this one. I've got several of these little containers, and I will just grab another container, and I'll separate my nylon from my hardware, and it'll just make it easier when I'm digging through my hardware looking for stuff. Now, I did leave my servo mount, horn mount screws there in that one. But, that way I'll keep them separated from the other hardware. But anyway, I go ahead and I open up my hardware bag and open up my nylon parts bag. And I dump them each into one of these little containers. And like I said, you can buy these containers at Walmart. They're very cheap. You can put lids on them. You can put a piece of tape on them and name them. That way when you come back, you've got all your stuff handy. It's hard to do a model all at once. And of course, if you work quite a few hours like I do, you just have to come back after work when you're not too tired or whatever. Or you get a day off and you have to come back to it and start on it again. And really, honestly, these parts get strode out and get mixed up with your other parts very quickly. And they're really hard to separate and tell what goes to what after a little bit of time goes by. So I do mark them. Lately I've been working on one plane, and since I've had bad weather, I've had a lot of time to work on planes, and so it's not so bad. But anyway, here we go. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to look in the book. Here's my horns. Okay. Here's my clevis ends. And these are L-bend ends, I guess you'd call them. And then they give you the little pieces of fuel line. Yeah, to use as safety clips, I guess you'd call them. Anyway, so I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to find my push rods, see which ones they say that I'm going to need, and see what screws they tell me to use. And once I get that done, I'll be back. Alright, I found everything I need. I've got my control surface, control horns. I've got my L-bend clevis end, and I've got my clevis end. I've got my 256 by half inch cap head screws. I've got my little silicone retainers. The only thing I'm going to need is I'm going to need my push rods. And they don't say which ones they are. It's not hard to tell which ones they are. They don't give you that many. I'm going to go ahead and get two of my push rods out here. And it's pretty standard, even though they don't need to be that long, they're going to give you these 12-inch ones, which are fine. More than you need, but it doesn't really matter. In fact, I need to make sure. Sometimes they give you like 6-inch ones instead of the 12, but they just give you the 12s on these, which there's nothing wrong with that. All right. So, for starters, I'm going to want to thread my clevis ends up on my rod. So I'm going to go ahead and pop my clevis into itself. That makes it a little easier to hold on to without spinning it. And then I'm going to get a little pair of pliers. And hold it way out here where I'm not going to use. That way I scar it up where it's going to cut off anyway. And I go ahead and I thread those up past the little ears made to hold the retainer. About an eighth past that is how far I thread those up. And I also went on my wing, I'll show you here in a minute. In the book, they tell you to go 7¾ inch from the inward edge of the aileron and put a mark. And that's marking to where your control horns will go. And so I did that, and I looked at it, and don't always guess that the book's going to be correct, because the book just isn't always right. But anyway, it looks like it's right, and I put a mark on each aileron at 7¾ inches. It's very easy to bend these control rods when you're doing this, so be careful not to bend them up. They're not hard to bend back, but why bend them up? All right. I got that, and I'm gonna go ahead and put my little silicone piece up on here, and I do that with a pair of hemostats. I slide it into my silicone piece and I put it over there. It works real good. And I don't want that up on that clevis yet. I want it back on the back side of the clevis, like that. Okay, now I'm gonna go ahead and do my other one real quick. And the same way, I'm gonna take my clevis and I'm gonna pop it into itself. Okay. Hold my control rod at the end where I don't scar it up. Put it on past the little ears. Okay, I got that threaded up a little more than an eighth. That one's almost a quarter, actually. I threaded in quite a ways. That way I've got a bunch of adjustment both ways. Once I get it on there, I could screw it out to make it longer, or I can screw it in to make it shorter. And if you put it right in the middle of the threads, you can have a little adjustment both ways. That's why I do that. Okay, now those two are ready. Now, my control horns here, they've got a little piece of, a little piece of plastic holding them between them, and I always get that little bump off. Be careful not to gouge yourself with the knife. I say that a lot. I say it a lot because I've done it a lot. And I'm thinking maybe if I could save somebody from doing it, it would be worth saying that often. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and cut those off. Alright, now, these are little cap head screws, and they're going to end up threading into this little back plate. So, what I've found is that once you get this on the aileron and stuff, and you're trying to thread these through, they won't thread very well. Because what you do is you take your Allen wrench that fits them, and you take your piece, and I usually set it down on the table or something where I can put some pressure against it. And I go ahead and put a little pressure against them, and I go ahead and thread them. I'm basically tapping these threads and run them through a little bit before I put it on the aileron. That way it'll be that much easier once I get it up there to thread these in. But the secret is having it against the table, where you can put a little pressure in it on it to get it started. And so once I get those started, I run them through just a little bit. Okay, there's that one. I'm gonna do the same on the next one here. And you actually don't have to always put it against the table, but it does make it a little easier. You can do it in your hand. See how much harder it is to hold if you do it in your hand. It's so much easier when you put it up against a surface to put some pressure on it and hold it straight while you get them started. And that's why they're so hard to get started once you put it on the aileron. And in the book they say, you know, that'll work a lot better if you go ahead and run a 256 tap through them, and that would work great too. But you don't really need a tap. These are nylon parts, they're pretty soft. If you put a little pressure against them as you start them, that's all you need. And the bolt will thread them just fine. All right. Now I've got my little end cap plate threaded. Now I've got one too many clevises out. I'll go ahead and put it up.
Alright. Now, I'm going to go ahead and set one of these up there, and I'm going to use my 1/16 drill bit. And I usually tank the ailerons in a fairly straight position. Probably not going to do that on this one. Let me see what I've got. Actually, maybe I will. You can hold it up and get it pretty close. No problem. I mean, you can get it pretty close. If I can find my tape here. Well, I don't see. Oh, there it is. Okay. Anyway, you can hold them there and you can get them pretty close. You really can. But, you're going to do a lot better job if you just go ahead and tape them. And even though this one doesn't have an edge to tape it against to get it straight, is all you got to do is hold the wing up and eyeball it, get it close, put your tape over. And then, of course, you do need to tape them from both sides because that way you've got a little bit of hold, especially on these large ones, because I'm going to be laying it against the table. And that'll be pushing on it. So I'm going to go ahead and hold it up again. See that I've got it pretty close to straight. And put another piece of tape on it. And that will hold it fairly straight. And as I said, fairly straight. It's not going to be perfect. And I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to set my control horn up there. And I'm going to try to center the holes right on the hinge. And this is always very important. To center those holes. So I've got it on my mark and I've got those holes centered, and I'm going to go ahead and move my stuff to the side here so I can put my arms up on the table and kind of brace myself. And I'm going to stick my tape under my edge here to help hold it up to keep my aileron in the position I want it to be in. Okay. Now, I'm going to hold my control horn right where I want it. I'm going to line it up on my mark, 7 3/4. I'm going to line my holes right up on my hinge, and I'm going to drill one hole. And I'm going to try to keep my angle of my drill about right to be the angle with my aileron, because I'm going to want that to be a hole straight through. Because I've got to match up with the other side. Now, I kind of got my hole started. Let me make sure it's in the right place here. It scooted on me a hair. And these drill all the way through. So trying to keep my angle right with the exact angle of my aileron, I'm going to go ahead and drill that all the way through. And I've said this more than once, but on this type of wood and everything, if you take, if you put much pressure on your drill when you're drilling it, it's just going to push through the wood. And that's just really bad. You're going to lose most of your strength that way. You have to go ahead and let the drill bit work. So don't put a whole lot of pressure on it. Now granted, these holes are awfully hard to get real straight through. So what I do, I go ahead and I start threading my 256 by half inch cap head screw. And I start threading it into my control horn. And then I go ahead and stick it in my hole there. And then I try to thread it through my hole. Okay, it should be protruding through my other side now. So I take my little end piece, my little piece that goes on the other side that I've already pre-tapped, and I stick it on there and start threading it up. Now this one's actually threading into the wood and pulling it very tight. You gotta watch for that, because it'll really smash your ends of your edges. So I'm gonna have to back it out and start it in again and ream out my hole. I don't like to smash that edge that much. I think it makes it look bad. Anyway, so I backed it out and I started threading it into my other plate. And hopefully I'll get it started in it here in a minute. Now that I got it started in my other plate, I'm going to back it out until the bottom plate comes up against my aileron on the other side, and there it is. And is what that'll do is it'll allow me to thread it through without putting pressure on this, because it's actually threading into the wood. Okay. Okay, I'm starting to get it fairly tight. Now make sure it's straight. And I'm going to drill my other hole. I'm going to make sure my little plate is straight on the other side. Okay. Okay. Now, of course I pulled my tape loose, but what I've done is I've got one screw threaded through this end, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to start my hole here, and I'm going to try to keep it straight. But I'm just going to go through a little ways. Okay. And then I'm going to go ahead and go to the back side, and I'm going to go through my other little piece, a small amount too. Is what that should do is do a much better job aligning these two holes, because if you don't do that, this hole, no matter what you do, will be a little ways off to match up with the other plate. But bends that I took and I went halfway through from both directions, it should line right up, and this usually works. Now I can push it against my table